With consideration of blockchain ecosystem re-architecting, such as with Tendermint and Cosmos, is a good segue now to mention the topic of week one. Alternative consensus mechanisms also provide a pathway to scalability. Tendermint BFT allows for thousands of transactions a second with 100 plus validators. And many other blockchain systems sporting novel consensus mechanisms also claim to have solved scalability too. Perhaps it's due to the specificity of their intended use case and some trust or security trade-offs. It's hard to tell at this point, so as an aside, as always, please do your own research in this. Let's take a moment to reflect on what we've learned this week. We started off by analyzing the pressing issue at hand, that Bitcoin and other similar blockchains have an inherent scalability issue. If the goal is to have these blockchains be used on a global scale, they need to support global transaction volumes, many, many orders of magnitude greater than what most mainstream current blockchain systems can support. There have also been many scalability proposals, but beyond scalability alone, there's also other issues of security and trust and decentralization, all factors in community adoption, the ultimate goal, really. For example, an issue with scaling Bitcoin might be the politics around its core development team, who would like to solve the issue of scalability without compromising Bitcoin's original vision of secure, decentralized, and trustless payments without major changes to the protocol, something that SegWit lined up with pretty well, but the Lightning Network not as much, with its tendency to hub and spoke. Upon understanding the scaling problem, we saw some fundamental ways to scale blockchains. Through simple dimensional analysis, we saw that we could either increase the volume of transactions or decrease the block time. We also recognized that choosing the direction in which to scale is important too. For example, if we just want a performance boost, what kind of numbers are we looking at, and what order of magnitude difference is it? The other question is whether instead to extend our blockchain outwards, adding new features. There's also the decision of where these scaling solutions can be built, for example, on or off-chain, and the corresponding trust implications that follow. The blockchain is the main source of truth, but it's perhaps the main bottleneck as well, since it has to process so much information all the time. And through our further analysis, we saw that the scalability problem was definitely more difficult than it seemed originally. Some miscellaneous concerns stem from the fact that scalability is not black and white. Perhaps in scaling up, we need to consider exactly what we want blockchains to do. At a higher level, there's scalability decisions to be made in terms of whether we want to engineer blockchains for speed first, optimizing for a single application, or rather architect for flexibility, for a potential blockchain platform or network. And pervading through all of this, of course, is politics, whether certain blockchains want to scale up. A trilemma we brought up towards the beginning of this week's material stated that scalability is just one aspect of blockchain's functionality. Perhaps a blockchain would rather focus on security or decentralization rather than scalability. There are inherent trade-offs between these three properties, such that it's harder to maintain decentralization and security, especially if we want to scale up. In fact, through most of the latter scalability solutions, there was usually some change in the regular blockchain trust structures. Again, to summarize what we've learned, let's tie back the two main ways of quickly categorizing scalability solutions. There's the layers of scaling, layer 1 and layer 2, specifying whether solutions are built on-chain or off-chain. There's also vertical and horizontal scaling, with diagonal scaling being a combination of the two. So let's step through all of the scaling solutions we learned. First, we tried tuning on-chain parameters for vertical scaling. We specifically looked at decreasing block time and increasing block size. These solutions seemed to be very naive at first, but further analysis brought us to solutions such as the Ghost Protocol, as implemented in Ethereum, mitigating the effect of wasted work on a system with fast block times. So here, we started looking at more involved scaling solutions, which involved complex engineering rather than just naively tuning parameters on-chain. We then looked at segregated witness, a method by which we can decrease the effective size of Bitcoin transactions by moving signature information from inside of transactions to a separate structure, a segregated witness. Recursive snarks, on the other hand, could allow us to prove the existence of transactions without storing the transactions themselves in a block. And the storage savings between these proofs and transactions is pretty high, though there are some issues with the trusted setup for verification of these proofs. Then, we looked at other ways to scale vertically, realizing that there's only so much we can do with our current blockchain systems as they are, we looked to layer 2 to achieve scalability off-chain. The first off-chain solution we looked at was vertical scaling via payment channels. We could lock up funds pairwise between users and conduct an arbitrary number of transactions off-chain, and then only post to the main chain when the users want to settle on a final balance, all summarized by two transactions on the main blockchain. But this only works pairwise between users. It becomes expensive if I want to conduct only a few transactions in this manner with someone else. So then came the idea of having networks of bidirectional payment channels, enabling transactions between any two nodes in the network, transversing through a series of payment channels. Implementations of such include the Lightning and Raiden networks for Bitcoin and Ethereum, respectively. Then we looked at ways to scale horizontally. It turns out that there are few horizontal scaling solutions that are also on layer 1, and sharding is by far one of the most researched and supported within the community. Alternatively, horizontal scaling can also be achieved through sidechains, pegging many individual blockchains together to expand their ease of interoperability within protocol. The potential of sidechains also extends very naturally to diagonal scaling as well, especially depending on the types of applications supported on sidechains. We then looked at Plasma, a proposal for Ethereum that has gained traction to work in conjunction with sharding. Plasma can increase the transaction volume of Ethereum since we can reduce the load on the root Ethereum chain and peg that to a child chain. This is when we realized that we could combine multiple complementary scaling solutions together. As it turns out, Plasma's open source specification and how implementations of Plasma, such as Blockchain of Berkeley's fourth state, have taken liberty in deciding how and where to run their child Plasma chains, it's easy to see how Plasma can scale blockchains out as well. Especially, building Plasma child chains on Cosmos enables modularity and flexibility. In Cosmos, hub and spoke blockchains create a network of interoperable blockchains. And finally, with Tendermint's integration within the Cosmos network and other modular blockchains, as well as in general novel alternative consensus mechanisms and the like, we realize that we can go back and scale blockchains vertically on-chain once again.